Hello and welcome to Conscious TV. My name is Ian McNay. And today we've got a very special guest. Since we started Conscious TV a few months ago, the number one requested guest in the consciousness section is Tony Parsons. And we're very lucky to have Tony here this morning. Good morning, Tony.
Hi.
And we're just going to talk a little bit about your life and your work and see what happens, see where it goes. We've got an open space for 45 minutes or so. So I'm just going to start, Tony, asking you a little bit about your childhood. I know when I was reading The Open Secret last night, you were saying that when you were very young, I think 3 years old, you did feel a sense of oneness, but then that went at one point.
Yes, it's what happens for most people. Initially, as far as this perception is concerned, as a very young child, a tiny child in iron arms, really, there is just beingness. There is no sense of identity at all. And then what happens with most people is that that beingness, which doesn't identify with anything, suddenly recognises another identity. So suddenly an identity, say the mother, appears. And directly the mother, let's say, appears, there's a sudden sense that there's someone here.
So like that's when separation emerges in one way.
That's the beginning of separation.
Yeah.
It is not a thought. It's just a sudden sense that there is now someone else in this beingness, in this wholeness. And when there's someone else in this wholeness, suddenly there's someone here. And this is the first identification. And that is the beginning of what I call the dream of individuality, where that identification takes place and then there's a sudden contraction of energy which makes that child think that they live in a body and everything that's happening outside them is something else. So that from then on, there's separation. And directly there is separation, there is seeking for wholeness again.
So you're trying to find what you had and in one way you lost.
Yeah. Or you didn't really have it, really. No one has wholeness. There is just wholeness.
No, I understand.
And what seems to happen is that in some way or other there's a sense of separation from wholeness and we grow up in a world full of individuals who actually in the end feel separate from wholeness.
And there's in all of us, even though we're not necessarily aware of it, there's this feeling of this is not quite it.
Absolutely.
And that's what we're seeking starts for most
Absolutely.
Of us. Yeah.
There's a sense of having lost something and there's a sense that the individual has to find it, and that's the misconception.
Yes. But you actually do remember this time when you were 2 or 3 years old to some extent, and that's great because in a way it's a reference point that's maybe helpful.
Mm. Certainly I can remember actually not as 3 years old, but more 7 years old, when I was then a person.
Right.
I still felt that everything that was happening was somehow saying something other than me being separate. There was something that was being said in everything that was inviting me to see that there wasn't any separation. It was just a sense. I couldn't, at that time, conceptualize it in that way. I just have. But there certainly was a sense that if there was a God, and of course as a tiny child you think there's a God, if there was a God and he loved me, then he would be talking to me in every way. In every way, through my body, through everything was out there. It was just an idea, it was just a sense of something.
Right. And I know also something I read that when you were in your teens, you investigated Christianity, you were somewhere drawn to that for a time.
Yes, I certainly was then a seeker like everyone else. So I looked at Christianity as one possibility, the answer to what I was looking for, and spent quite some time looking at that, a few years, looking quite intently at that possibility, and then I just discarded it. Because somewhere for me, it was still saying that in some way or other, I had to become worthy to be whole.
There was a whole baggage of
lessons and teachings about how I should become worthy to become everything or to become whole.
Yeah.
And it just, in the end, just fell apart for me. It just didn't mean anything. So I then looked at other things.
What kind of other things did you look at?
Osho.
This was still in your teens or
was
later on?
Well, Osho was later on.
Yes,
I looked at Gurdjieff, Uspensky, all of that lot.
Yeah.
I was looking here and there at various different ideas about this.
Yeah.
And then later on, I left my previous life and went to the Osho commune for about 3 years. But near the end of that 3 years, I then saw that in a way, I was still being given a list.
Yes, yeah.
You know, go to therapy, meditate, all the different things that dear old Osho, bless his heart, in a way was recommending. So then again, there was something about that that just didn't ring a bell.
So when you were around 21, I think, again, I read somewhere that you one day you were walking on a park in Balham in South London, and you said something to God, show me your face.
Well, there was, there was that intensity somewhere in me. And I was walking across the park, and although at the time I thought I was doing it, in fact, there was a noticing that every footstep was uniquely different and never would be there again. That was all that came into me. I wasn't doing that. It was just an idea or a sense that everything was totally new and unique. And suddenly, I wasn't there anymore. So there was Tony Parsons, and there was nothing. There was no Tony Parsons. There was nothing. No experience of it. There was no experiencer. There was just nothing. Bang.
Right.
Or absolute love, if you want. And then I walked out of the other side, and I was still a seeker. I was still seeking. And what I now wanted was that.
You wanted to get back to that feeling. I wanted to get back to
it, although I couldn't know it. I wanted to get back to that. So I then went on in various other ways to try and really, in a way, remember or grasp what couldn't be grasped.
So it's like a reference point somehow.
Yeah.
Is that right?
Yeah. I don't know about a reference point. I think a lot of people have glimpses of oneness, let's call it, or wholeness. And then they there's something that's recognised there, but when they come out of the other side of that, they then think that they can get to that, which I thought. They then think they had to find that and embrace it.
Yeah.
And that, and then later, much later on, what actually happened was that there was an individual seeker looking for this, and then suddenly there just wasn't.
Yeah.
It was over. There was no individual seeker. And what came out of that was the open secret. And also, I have to say, not for anyone, but the realization that the whole idea that there is something called an individual seeker that has to find something else called enlightenment is totally misconceived.
And how did this realization change, whatever you call it, happen? And, you know, what was the circumstances?
Well,
were you looking more intensely than usual?
No, the circumstance was that I wasn't anything anymore. There was no individual. What I call liberation happened when I was much older. And when that liberation happened, which was the end of there being anyone, any individual seeker, it simply collapsed. And there was nothing left. We can talk about that in a minute, what that's like. But there was nothing left. There was no individual. There was only what was happening. There was only life. But in that, there was a realization that the idea that an individual had to make effort or purify themselves or become worthy to find this was completely and utterly misconceived.
But what I'm particularly interested in, were, as an individual beforehand, were you looking particularly intensely to try and find something, or was it kind of some people say they give up and something happens? What was kind of going on with you as an individual?
Okay, so as an individual, about a year before this happened, I wrote a great big thick book, which I never published, which was full of lists.
Okay.
It was really talking in the same language. I'm an individual and I, you know, and maybe I can find this and maybe you can. And then I suddenly realised, like the Osho thing and the Christianity, that the whole thing was ridiculous. It wasn't. That wasn't it. That wasn't the answer. I threw the book away and went and played golf. So I just, there was no sense.
Don't touch the microphone, otherwise it'll
there was no sense, you know, anymore that what I thought I could find could be found by me. So for a year I just played golf. I just played around. And we had a business that we were running, but I was doing nothing in terms of seeking in that way. Although subtly, of course, we're all seeking. But and then suddenly, in the middle of the night, a sentence came to me and I rushed downstairs and wrote it on. But at the same time, I was no more. It was just that I woke up in the night and there was no one.
And what did no one write down? What was the sentence?
Oh, no one wrote down. It's on page 4 of the Open Secret. It's one paragraph. But it was the basis of the Open Secret.
Right.
And of course, it was a communication that was coming out of no one.
Right.
So the Open Secret, I didn't write the Open Secret. I don't give meetings. They are what this, you know, there's no one sitting here. This is what's happening.
So that is very hard for someone to grasp,
yeah.
Especially someone that hasn't done a lot of seeking in themselves, that they see you, they know you have a name, Tony, mm. and you have a red sweater and a blue shirt, and the guy's saying there's no one there.
That, yeah, okay.
That's a tough one.
Okay. It's not tough. It's not difficult. It's impossible. As far as the individual is concerned, there's no way that the individual can even conceive, but certainly sense, the idea that there is no individuality, that there's no one, and all there is what's happening. It's impossible. It can't happen because the nature of individuality is to be separate and seek. So it's always moving forward. It's always moving, looking for something. What's next? What's next? Where can I get to? But what hasn't been realised by the individual is that there never was anything lost. The dilemma for the individual is not that the individual can't get what it wants. The dilemma is the individual.
Okay. It's
just, you know, this message is a complete revolution around the other way of the way we normally look at seeking and enlightenment and all those things.
Well, it is, it's tough. I use the word tough, you use the word impossible, mm. because the more intelligent members of the human race realise something is missing, mm. they realise something's not quite right, and we all go through this, you know, I think you did the same, you were quite successful mm. in your business, mm. you make some money, you have a relationship, maybe some people have children, obviously, and yet, whatever happens, after a time, there's still this feeling, this isn't it. And so some people just try and, you know, they drink a little bit too much or whatever, and they just put it under the carpet. Other people that may be a little bit more, I would say, intelligent, aware, whatever.
Sensitive, yeah.
Yeah. They think, well, this isn't quite right. I'm going to do something about this. Because in our society, it is very much a doing society. Mm. And it is that ultimate dilemma that they're, in a way, being intelligent, in quotes, and yet it doesn't work.
No, of course it doesn't work because they're trying to do something and get to somewhere.
Yeah, yeah.
What the Open Secret is saying is there is nowhere to get to.
Yeah.
And of course, more importantly, there is no one to get there. The whole idea that there's such a thing as individual free will and choice is totally exposed as a fallacy.
Yeah.
But it's the most difficult message of all in my recent thing on the website. There's nothing for sale.
Yeah.
There's nothing for the individual. I would go as far as to say that the individual actually doesn't want this because the individual fears most its own absence.
But something happens around you because we've had other people on Conscious TV, and I've also talked to people too that haven't been on Conscious TV that said the same thing. They go to your meetings and some of them leave and something seems to have really happened. And some even say, well, I went to a meeting with Tony and I never left the meeting.
No.
That's what they say. And I think, well, it's not just one person. It's more than one.
Oh,
I
yeah,
think, well,
it's happening a great deal. You see, really, I'm sorry.
No.
The thing that happens is resonance happens. It's not a conceptual. This message isn't about words or ideas. What happens is something resonates. Something is remembered. What is remembered is the beingness of childlike wonder.
Yes.
There's something that, it isn't about me getting somewhere, it's about a resonance with something that is.
Yes.
And so what drops away is the idea of me getting somewhere.
So let me just try, you'll probably shoot this down, but is it a possibility that something is vibrating in you, something latent is vibrating in someone else, and something kind of gets activated.
Yeah, okay, so it isn't in me. The power of the meetings is that there's no one there. in a sense. Therefore, there's no one who's trying to give somebody else a list or has any expectations of it. And also the other powerful thing is that there's no one in the audience that is seen as an individual, because the idea of whole sense of individuality is an illusion.
Yeah.
So there's something very powerful about that.
Yeah.
And the other powerful thing is there's nobody trying to sell anybody anything. And it's amazing the effect that has on people, because a lot of the audience who are sensitive to this know that this isn't something that's trying to be sold, or it's not, nobody's trying to make somebody else believe anything. And what happens is not mine, but what happens is boundlessness.
Boundlessness.
So is the contracted energy of individuality, which is totally embodied, it's not just an idea or a thought or a belief. Individuality and separation is a totally embodied feeling of being restricted. And people walk into the room and there's a sense of whom.
Yeah.
But it's nothing to do with me because I ain't there. It's just that in some way or other there's a resonance with that.
And this whom is something sitting there aware of the womb happening?
No.
It's just
that
you.
Way.
It's not. It just. No. I have to use these words like you. I have no other way of addressing it. For you, it's just normal somehow that the womb is.
Yeah,
always
it's there,
there.
Already. In a sense, you know, everything is new. Everything is boundless already. So I don't. I can't say, oh, Mary's just popped or something. But you know, it just is what happens. There's a huge inspiration in the room. Often you can sense a feeling of wow, and new people that come either walk out and hate it because I'm telling them that they had no free will, or I'm suggesting they haven't.
Yeah,
but a lot of the audience just wow, it's amazing. it's just gorgeous.
So, what's your feeling about the whole Osho thing now?
Oh, as far as I'm concerned, there are two totally different ways of looking at it. There are totally two different communications, really. The classically normal communication is that there is an individual who is separate, and the individual can find what it's looking for, i.e. enlightenment, liberation, or whatever you like, the kingdom of heaven, if you want. And that is completely divorced from what is being spoken of out of the open secret. And not only the open secret, there are other people, very few, who are communicating this message, that this revolutionary message, that in fact there is no one, there is no individual, and there's nothing that can be done.
Yeah.
It isn't then saying that you can't do anything, because then it would be implying that there's a you there that can't do anything. Yeah. It is saying there is nothing that can be done. There's nothing that needs to be done, because everything already is whole. But that's largely conceptual. You know, that's words. I mean, some people say, oh, the I is just a thought, or, a separation is just a belief, so if you see through it, then it'll vanish. That's talking about the symptom. The thought of being separate is a symptom of being separate. But being separate is a really felt, embodied feeling that makes people want, long for something else. It's a longing. It's a sense of loss. So it's a very energetic, held feeling. And somewhere, somehow, people come and just explode out of it.
And the explosion, is that the start of something or the end of something? How do you...
What's interesting is that obviously there are a lot of things, a lot of energy, boundlessness is there in the meeting. But the interesting thing is, with the residentials and so on, is that quite often that explosion takes place afterwards.
So they get back to their normal environment and something happens,
We talk to a lot of people that this is happening to. And, you know, quite often it's, it's after the meeting. Richard, you know, sitting in a train on Charing Cross station.
Yeah, Sylvester, yeah.
Just after a meeting. It's just strange, I don't know. But it can happen in a meeting as well. And the other thing that does happen in a meeting is a lot of laughter. Okay. Huge amount of laughter.
Yeah.
About how strange this is and how... People laugh at themselves chasing around for years, meditating and opening their chakras and forgiving their mother. You know, it's sort of suddenly the funny side of that is.
Yeah. It's almost like an apprenticeship in some ways for a lot of people. They kind of try. It's kind of you try all these things and you find it doesn't work, but somehow you need to try it. I don't know.
It certainly is what happens. I don't think anybody needs anything in another sense, but that is what seems to happen. Mind you, I have to say that I know, and maybe you do, but there are other people who never seek and this happens to.
Yeah.
Just, you know, they've never, can't even spell the word enlightenment and suddenly.
Yeah, well, we talked about this before we started. Yeah. This guy, John Wren Lewis, who is an English guy, he died recently and he was living in Australia.
Mm.
And he did some research. Something happened with him. He wasn't a seeker and he basically took a poison sweet on a bus in Thailand.
Right, yeah.
He went unconscious, was taken to hospital, almost died, but not quite. Mm. And when he woke up, it's whatever had happened, and his life was completely different. Mm. And he did some research. I was reading on the web that he did some research, and he's looking for similar people who he felt were in a same thing happened, or similar thing happened to them that happened to him. And he found that 75% of the people he found had done nothing like he hadn't before. Yeah. It just happened.
Yeah. We had a publican friend in Ireland, we go to Dublin, who, I mean, had no more interest in this than flying the air. And he was walking along one day and suddenly the whole thing was over. He vanished and there was just everything.
Yeah.
And he got in touch with a doctor who said to him, oh, that's Buddhism. And he went to
him. Really? The doctor said that?
Yeah, well, it's quite sweet in a way, because that was the nearest he could get to it. And then he went to a Buddhist meeting. No, this isn't it. He went to a few others. Yeah. And it just so happened that he heard about me being in Dublin. He came in the sat down in the and that, he said, that's it.
Yeah.
Bang. But he had no interest in it.
You know, these kind of things on a personal level really fascinate me. And one of the last interviews I did a few days ago for Conscious TV was a guy called Benjamin Zephaniah.
Right.
Now, he's basically, you'd call him, he's a Rastafarian poet, kind of a punk poet. And I met him actually in we're both involved with an organisation called the Prison Phoenix Trust, which helps supply teachers of yoga and meditation to prisons. And he's one of their patrons. And he was telling me his life story. And he was saying, basically, he was brought up in Birmingham. You know, he was in a gang. He got to the point that he was sleeping with a gun underneath his pillow at night. And then one morning he woke up and said, he just had a realization, if I do this for one more day, I'm either going to be dead or in prison. He'd been in prison once, in prison again.
Mm.
So he just left everything and went to London and made a living out of his poetry. And I don't think he necessarily say there was no one there or realisation, but it was a kind of realisation.
Yeah.
And it just happened like that. He woke up, his whole life changed.
Yeah.
And that for me is just...
Okay, as far as I'm concerned, he didn't, you know, it wasn't him having the realisation happened.
I think you're absolutely
just
right.
It's just...
Yeah, that's right. It's not necessarily the level of oneness, but something significant happened, and it happened in a moment. Just woke up. Yeah. And it changed my life.
Yeah.
And I think more and more that's available to people. And it's, I suppose, in a way, there has to be an element of courage. Is that right? Or
No, as far as I'm concerned, there doesn't have to be anything. There are no circumstances that bring this about. And there's no state a person has to be in. You know, you can be in a cave in the Himalayas eating rice or lying in the gutter, pissed out of your mind. And this will happen because it has nothing to do with you.
And it's no, and there's no going back because it's like final.
Oh, totally final. Liberation, so-called liberation, there is no such thing, but it's a word we use. In liberation, it is the end of something that was never happening. It's the end of an illusion, and it can't come back because there's nothing it can come back to. It's the end.
Yeah.
And it can't be described in a sense. We were talking about this just before. The only way I can describe what this is like is that there's just what's happening. There's no one that anything is happening to. Everybody watching this might be sitting on a chair watching it. I don't know. It doesn't matter. But when they watch it, it's possible to suddenly realise that there isn't anybody sitting on a chair. All there is sitting on a chair. It's as simple as that. It's totally simple, and for the individual, it's very frightening.
So are you saying there can be anxiety after it happens? Are you talking about an individual who's watching this happen with someone else? Are you talking about...
No, what I'm talking about is the proposal that the liberation is about the absence of the individual. It's the end of individuality.
So until it happens,
that's frightening for an individual.
Of course it is.
The idea of ending their, in a way that everything they think they are is frightening. But the strange thing is that all it is the end of is a total illusion. It's just like a piece of smoke that's there that you really believe in, and then suddenly it's not there. And life just goes on. Life obviously goes on. This thing drives a car and walks in here and talk, you know. Everything goes on in free fall. It's just total free fall. I think the other thing that's frightening is people believe, it's very sweet, but people actually believe that they are the managing directors of their life and that they control their life. After there is no one, it's realised that there isn't any control. But that's frightening it also. I will lose control. What will happen if I'm not here? Well, what happens is life. It was always like that.
So what happens to your personality?
Well, as far as the character is concerned, the physiology and the neurology of the actual, you know, let's call it a character. There's no one in there. The body, the person, that goes on and is now free to even be more of a personality or a character, because there's nothing in there. There's nothing in there judging it. There's no little me saying, "Oh, you shouldn't talk like that or be like that." What we see with people is they become more so. In the colour of them, in their taste of them, in the way they speak, in their bodies. You can see it in their bodies. They're totally, you know. But there's no one in there doing that.
But the personality is just a programme, basically. That
totally. It's a programmed... The brain is the most amazing instrument, which actually correlates and works out everything that we are, you and I are now doing, you know. There isn't anybody doing this. The brain is doing this. Well, like, in other words, in the end, being is simply waving its arms around and appearing to be a person.
But the personality is, as we kind of say, we know, but a lot of people understand it to be, it's formed from your experiences, especially young experiences when you're 3, 4, 5 years old, whatever, forms the basis. And then everything that happens somehow shapes you. And what you're saying is that keeps running.
Absolutely.
As the personality.
Yeah.
Now, what about the gross side of the personality? Does that
the neurotic drive to find oneness simply falls away, and then there's something that's very harmonious there that was there anyway. But the whole neurotic drive to find, which is, or you know, there isn't anybody in the world that isn't actually seeking oneness in the end. What we see in the manifestation is simply the longing to come home. All desire is a longing to come home. That falls away, and anything that's around that, that's neurotic, falls away. But the character still goes on. You know, habits, preferences still happen, but they aren't anybody's. It's the brain functioning in the world.
How about, quote, bad habits? Do they go on?
They could, although to some extent, again, or the habit of drinking too much, let's say, doesn't matter. Is really only a seeking for the comfort of not being whole. So when that isn't there anymore, there wouldn't be a wish to drink a lot or smoke a lot.
Okay.
But all those are addictions, but the greatest addiction of all, of course, is me.
Yes. You've got a great laugh. It's I've never met you before. I've never seen you before. So
yeah.
It's a great laugh. It's infectious.
Mm.
But this point really interests me, so I'm going to persevere a little bit on it, that's okay. So let's say somebody, let's take the example of this guy, Benjamin, I used. Okay, he had his realisation with the gun. Now let's say he hadn't had it at that point, and he did, and he was in a situation, and he, you know, he used the gun or whatever, or was thinking of using the gun. After whatever happened to you, liberation happens. Is he still capable of killing somebody?
It's possible, but there isn't anybody in there that would do that. Nobody's ever killed anybody. The whole illusion that the added, you know, individualism is real is a fallacy. So there isn't anybody that chooses to do anything. Of course, the whole body, mind, the whole physiology acts in the way it does and in character. But the whole idea that anybody has ever chosen to do anything falls apart. But you can't then say after liberation that this will happen and that won't.
No, I understand that, but I'm looking for a kind of more of a, it is my mind, but I'm looking for an understanding of how the personality refines, let's say. That's the word I'm using, it wasn't your word, but you were kind of inferring that the addiction drops away. And wouldn't like a gun or violence, wouldn't that drop away as an addiction? Because that's a grossness.
It would do, but I can't say it will.
No, I understand that.
There aren't any rules. Yeah. There's boundlessness. And in boundlessness, which is actually simply absolute love.
Yeah.
It's the absolute unconditional love. Of course, unconditional love embraces everything. Tyranny, ugliness, discomfort. After liberation, discomfort still happens. You know, it isn't suddenly that you're walking in the Elysian fields in absolute heaven.
Yeah.
There's nobody walking. There's just what happens. And that can include pain, you know, pain, discomfort, all those things happen. So there aren't any rules. You can't say that liberation is about what we think of as goodness.
Okay. And would you in your space, that's the nearest I can get in my language to where you are, would you experience fear, anxiety sometimes?
I wouldn't experience fear, but fear happens.
Okay.
So there's nobody anymore experiencing anything. There's just what happens, and that can include fear.
And that fear is happening in your personality, presumably?
It's just happening. It's a feeling. I mean, in the end, fear is a very simple thing. It's just a feeling in the body, isn't it? It's a sense of something hot, and if you like, which happens. But, of course, now that it's not happening to anyone, there's nobody taking delivery of it. There's nobody taking fear home to tea.
Right, so it's
not
got
some... And
the most
important thing is thinking. Thinking still happens after liberation, but there's no one listening.
Okay, so the fear can't really anchor itself.
No, there's nothing to anchor it onto. It falls back out into nothing. Everything comes out of nothing and falls back into it.
Okay.
It's like there's no, you know, after liberation, there's no me, therefore there's no stickiness. It's one way I put it, you know.
Yeah.
There's just life, and there's nothing getting in the way. Identifying with it.
Did you dream?
Oh yeah, I don't, but dreaming happens.
Dreaming happens,
I'm sorry
yeah.
to be... I'm
no,
not
it's all right,
excited.
I understand what you're
dreaming
saying.
Dreaming happens.
Yeah, yeah. And are they interesting dreams? Or
it doesn't really matter, but the dreams after liberation are much more ordinary than they were before.
They're more ordinary?
Ordinary.
Yeah.
I mean, this is about something that is totally simple and ordinary. This is absolutely about something that's utterly simple and ordinary and absolutely stunning. Because, you see, there isn't anything anymore that's making calculations about what's happening. There's nothing that's looking at you and saying to itself, now how can I manipulate this situation with this person over there? That's all gone. Everything that arises is new. It's totally living in newness. It's like living in loveness. Because in love, falling in love has a very similar quality to this, because falling in love, in a sense, is beyond person. It's about being in love with love.
You talk about unrequited love on the front page of your website. Mm. Yeah.
My sense is that, you know, we're fascinated by unrequited love, the story of because it, in a sense it points to what we're really looking for, which we can't know and have, which is ultimate, absolute, unconditional love. So we can't know that, and we're fascinated by the whole story of not being able to find our love in someone else. Because somewhere subtly we absolutely know that the love we really long for is ultimately unknowable. But what's amazing about that love is that it's here in this room right now. That ultimate love is singing in our bodies, in everything. It's singing the song that the individual can't hear. Because the individual's looking for it. Where is it? It's here. It's this. Do you know, one of the loveliest things that happens, and many, many people this is happening to, I get a lot of phone calls from people saying, do you know, I've been a seeker, I've looked for this, I've looked for that, I've looked for, you know, the whole list. Now this has happened, what's realised is that what I was looking for has never left me. It was always this.
Yeah. Actually, that touches me when you say that. Yeah.
Yeah.
I can feel that. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. It's
the bag on the microphone.
That's it too. That's this too. But it's, you know, it's there right now. It's not, you don't have to be anything or become anything for it to be there. It's just waiting for you to give up looking for it. You know what I mean? It's just sitting there loving you and loving everything. Amazing. I mean, I'm still stunned by it. You can probably tell. I think it's the most amazing message there is. It's so simple and immediate. When people phone me up and say, oh, tell me a story about them, because they're still individuals in the story. Yeah, yeah. I say, so all there really is there is sitting on a chair holding a phone. It's amazing the effect that has on people. Because they're on about, you know, he doesn't love me or my mother's dying or whatever.
Yeah.
And suddenly there's an immediate bringing back to just what there really is, what there only is.
You see, there's not a lot of support for what you're saying in one way.
No.
You look at the whole media thing at the moment where, you know, we're November today, 2008? Yeah, I almost forgot for a minute. And you know, everything just seems so unstable.
Oh, yeah.
You know, the banks nearly collapsed a few weeks ago, and there was terrible problems somewhere in Africa on the news this morning with people rioting and no food. You feel sorry for them. Mm. Does that, when you watch the news on TV, like you see people suffering, does that somehow affect Tony?
Well, there is no Tony, but what is seen is what's happening. Of course, the other thing that's amazing about this, I mean, I meet people who think they're individuals and are suffering in a much smaller degree than Uganda or wherever it is, the Congo.
I think.
But in a sense, what's happening is that they feel they're suffering and they think that suffering is happening to them. But when, from this point of view, it is seen that there's no one there that's happening to, that's absolute love. And in some way or other, that which thinks it's suffering senses that. There's nobody suffers, there's just suffering.
Yeah, and I guess...
But, I mean, it's easy to say that. Those are just words.
Yeah, and those people, they don't have... overview. They don't have food. Their kids are starving.
It would be totally inappropriate for me to go to the Congo and say, there's no one there. Yeah. But in answer to your question, that's the leap.
Yeah. Is there hope for humanity?
There doesn't have to be, because everything that's happening is simply the expression of wholeness.
Yeah.
Wholeness isn't interested in, you know, somehow saving this earth or anybody becoming enlightened, because seeking and suffering is wholeness.
On the other hand, it seems that what wholeness may be doing, I know you're going to say wholeness doesn't do anything, but in my terms, what is maybe happening is that it's becoming so obvious to humanity on a global scale, this whole set of rules we've got or whatever doesn't work anymore.
No.
The whole thing of consumerism and debt and having more and more, it's just such an obvious message. Mm. And it's, for many people, it's a devastating message because they don't really know anything else.
No.
Especially in the United States, it's just devastating for them.
Totally. There's a total investment in the individual. But the other fascinating thing about this message is that neuroscientists are coming to the same conclusion. They're working with the brain people, and they are coming to the conclusion very strongly, although you don't hear much about it, of course, that there is no such thing as an individual with free will and choice.
Yeah.
That the whole thing is run in here from that point of view. I mean, they don't talk about wholeness, of course, but they're just, it's interesting.
Well, I don't know, someone was sitting on that chair, I don't know, 2 or 3 months ago, woman called Manji, and she's written a book called Punk Science. She's actually a medical doctor, but she's done a lot of physics. And she was saying, and I have heard this before, that basically what happens is when in science you look and you try and find the center of something, actually you never find anything. I'm looking at you, magnify. And all you ever found, so far, I think it's string theory, is a suggestion that something may have been there.
Yes.
They don't find scientifically.
No.
Anything tangible.
No.
And the other thing she was saying, which I thought absolutely fascinating, was that It's like this holographic principle that every tiny whatever it is, even though there's nothing there, every tiny, and she had a phrase for this, and I forget what it was.
Doesn't matter.
Contains everything.
Yes, it does. Because you see, what's fascinating is that, for instance, so far the quark is supposed to be one of the smallest things that scientists discovered.
Yeah.
What they discovered to their alarm is that it both is and isn't.
That's right.
It isn't that it is and then isn't. It actually is and isn't. Yeah. So there's nothing that's real or unreal.
Yes, and we're all apparently full of black holes. There's black holes everywhere, different sizes. Yeah. And the other thing was, which just blew my mind, was that from a scientific point of view, and you may disagree with this, I don't know, but all we experience is 4% of reality.
Yeah.
There's another 96% on different levels of reality that we just do not experience happening at the same time.
No, that is so, but in another sense for me, it is that as a separate individual, nothing is seen as it really is because it's seen through like cling film or a veil. It's like everything that the individual sees from the point of view of being separate and something here looking at something else. After liberation, that completely collapses and everything is simply what it is. Absolutely what it is, simply as it is.
As you
it's
see
a totally different
as
scene.
It's seen in that moment.
Yeah, it is, yeah.
Yeah. And do you see other dimensions, things like
no,
that
No, I don't
sometimes?
Need to, because this is enough.
Yeah.
There's no need to see other dimensions or anything grand or strange. This is a miracle. This is just a miracle, you know. Why bother? You know, well, why would you if there's only in loveness with this?
Yeah. But maybe they appear, who knows?
Yeah,
the appropriateness
they do, it's
of oneness.
Just wholeness appearing as
a
strange form.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm just going to, just for a second, because I'm sure there was something else I really wanted to ask you, although I think we've covered most of it.
Mm.
Yeah, I highlighted this thing, in essence, what is sought is love, which you've kind of talked about that. And
ultimate
that's
love, yeah.
Kind of, if you had a message, and I know that in a way you don't have a message because no one have a message, but That is the important
totally.
Thing.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
You could call wholeness absolute unconditional love. They're all words, you know.
Yeah.
But yes, that's basically what we long for, is the ultimate love that we absolutely know, we absolutely remember as tiny child, as a tiny child. We're just trying to return to childlike wonder.
Yeah. And that's how children often are, isn't it?
Yeah,
something.
And that's what we sense in tiny child.
Yeah.
Just this.
Yeah. And that's happening with you moment to moment, this
wonder.
Well,
it's just happening.
Just happening, yeah. It sounds amazing.
It's amazing for no one.
Okay, Tony. Thanks very much for coming on the Conscious TV.
Thank you.
And thank you for watching. And we'll see you again soon, hopefully. Goodbye.